Yakışır. So today's class is introduction to embryology, and embryology is science that deals with development and growth of an individual for birth. So this is the science which deals with the development and growth of an individual before birth, that is in the womb, in the womb of the birth. It begins with the fertilization of an oocyte by a sperm and culminates with the birth of the baby. So this embryology beginning with the fertilization of oocyte, that is the period of the, I mean the period which is described as embryology. So it begins with the fertilization of oocyte by a sperm and ends with the birth of a baby. The entire period of development from fertilization to birth is termed as prenatal development. The period of prenatal development is also called gestation period or pregnancy. So this embryology deals with the period of prenatal period, gestation period or pregnancy. The term pregnancy means carrying products of concept for a period of 38 weeks extending from fertilization to birth. So the term pregnancy means carrying products of conception for a period of 38 weeks extending from fertilization to birth. Stages of human life. It is divided into prenatal and postnatal development first. So the human life is divided into prenatal period, that is before birth and after birth. So those the development that is taking place in those periods. Now period of prenatal development is divided again into three periods. Pre-embryonic period extends from conception to the end of second week of embryonic life. So this pre-embryonic period extends from the fertilization to the end of the second week of embryonic life. Next, embryonic period extends from the beginning of the third week to the end of the eighth week of embryonic life. So that is ending by second week, and this is starting from third week to eighth week, embryonic period. And fetal period, that is beginning of the ninth week to birth, growth and specialization of the body structure. So here the prenatal development, pre-embryonic period, we are seeing the conception to second week, that during which fertilization, cleavage, implantation, formation of germ layers occurring. So in the period of pre-embryonic period we are seeing fertilization, cleavage, implantation and formation of germ layers occurring. Whereas in the embryonic period, that is beginning from the third week to end the eighth week, here what is happening is formation of placenta, umbilical cord, extra embryonic membranes, differentiation of germ layers into specific body parts. So here we are seeing formation of placenta, umbilical cord, extra embryonic membranes, differentiation of germ layers into specific body parts. Next, fetal period, that is beginning of ninth week to birth. Here we will see growth and specialization of body structures. So we are seeing specialization of body structures and growth of the body in this fetal period. So fetal period extends from the beginning of ninth week to birth of the baby. Now postnatal development, the development of individual from birth to about 25 years called postnatal development. Periods of postnatal development we are calling infancy, from birth to first year. Childhood, from second to 12th year of age. Puberty, from 13 to 16 years of age. Adolescence, 17 to 18 years of age. Adulthood, 19 to 25 years of age. So up to this 25 years there will be some changes in the body, some developmental changes in the body. Now the infancy period ranges from birth to birth, first year of age, and then and the newborn during this period is called infant. So infancy is the period from birth to the end of the first year, and during this period we call calling this newborn as infant. The first 4 weeks of this period are very critical for the survival of newborn, because the transition from intrauterine to extrauterine existence requires many changes, especially in the cardiovascular and respiratory system. So the first 4 weeks of the period is very critical for the survival of newborn, because the transition from the intrauterine to extrauterine existence life requires many changes, especially in cardiovascular and respiratory system. The changes include, so suppose say in the intrauterine life, the baby is getting its nutrition and oxygen from the blood of the mother. That is, in the placenta, the exchange is going on. Whereas extrauterine life, once the baby has come out of the uterus, it has to get oxygen from the atmosphere, that is occurring in the lungs. So the changes occur in lungs as well as the circulation. The circulation, which previously used to go to placenta for purification and for restoration of the oxygen, now it is going to the lungs. So these changes will occur in cardiovascular system and respiratory system to adjust from the external internal environment to the external intrauterine environment to the extrauterine environment. During this period, there is a rapid growth of body. This period is called neonatal period, and newborn during this period is called neonate. So in the first 4 weeks, we are calling it as neonatal period, and we are calling the baby as neonate. The care of baby during this period is termed as neonatology. So the science that deals with the care of the baby during this neonatal period, we are calling it as neonatology. So neonate, neonatal period, neonatology. The term perinatal period extends from 28th week of pregnancy to the end of 6th day of birth. So another term is there, which is coined by the clinicians to say perinatal period. This is extending from 28th week of pregnancy to the end of 6th day of birth. That is perinatal period. Now child, the care of children during this period is exciting because of constancy of changes in their growth and development. So childhood, starting from first year to 12 years, where we have seen the various changes in the body's growth, the development of various activities, the development of the mental status, all these things we are seeing gradual, the development of your speech. And these things will be exciting to look at. The children do not stay the same during this period. So they will be constantly changing in their physical structure as well as their mental structure. As the children grows, the rate of growth slows down. But just before puberty, the growth accelerates. This is called pre-pubertal growth spurt. So as the children grows, the growth rate slows down. Almost after 8 years, up to 10 to 12 years it will be less, then pre-pubertal spurt will be there around 10 to 12 years, wherein the growth accelerates. The medical subject dealing with care of children in health and diseases are pediatrics. So here the subject that deals with the development, health and disease of children, that is age between 1 year to 12 years, we are talking as pediatrics. Puberty. So the infancy is over, changing is over, puberty. Pubertas means development of sex characters. Puberty is the period ranges from 12 to 15 years in female and 13 to 16 years in male. So during this period, there is very rapid physical growth and development of secondary sex characters and capability of sexual reproduction is attained. So in the puberty is a period wherein the sex organs are developed. This is ranging from 12 to 15 years in female career and 13 to 16 years in male applicant. 12 to 15 years in female and 13 to 16 years in male. During this period, there is very rapid physical growth and development of secondary sex characters, and the capability of sexual reproduction is attained. So during this period, there is rapid physical growth. That means the person attains, a greater size of the body. The person attains almost a full development to the adult level. And then here, the sex characters are, secondary sex characters are being developed. And now, capability of sexual reproduction is also attained. So here, in this period, the child is attaining capability of sexual reproduction and it is getting the development of secondary sexual characters and of course rapid growth. The growth during puberty is dependent on the interaction of the growth hormone and sex steroids. So the growth is during this puberty period, that is 12 to 15 years in female and 13 to 16 years in male, is depending on the interaction between the growth hormone and sex steroids. Now adolescence ranges from 17 to 18 years. This period is characterized by rapid physical growth and sexual maturation. The gonads begin to secrete testosterone and estrogen. During this period, ability to reproduce is achieved. Adulthood ranges from 19 to 25 years. During this period, full growth and development of body organs, including ossification of bones, is actually completed. So, in the adulthood, the growth is complete and the ossification of bones is completed, and so there will be no more, growth after this 25 years in most of the persons. So, these are the various stages of the human life. So it starts from the periods of prenatal development. Prenatal development means that is development before birth, that is pre-embryonic period up to second week of life, intrauterine life. Then embryonic period, 38th week. Then fetal period, 9th to birth, 9th to 38 weeks, say. Now fetal period from beginning of 9th week to the birth of the baby. Now, postnatal development, the development of embryo from birth to about 25 years called postnatal. Here we are seeing infancy, childhood, puberty, adolescence, and adulthood. In the adulthood, the growth ceases, the ossification of bones completed, and the person is completely developed by adulthood. That's about the various stages of the human. Now we go for the phylogenetics. This is the study of evolutionary relationships among biological entities, often species, individuals, or genes, which may be referred to as taxa. Major elements of phylogenetics are summarized as follows. So, phylogenetics is the study of evolutionary relationships among biological entities. Often species, individuals, or genes. So, this phylogenetics deals with the evolution and its relation during the evolution with other species or individuals or genes. So, evolution of a particular species or individual and its relations during development with the other species or individuals, we are calling as phylogenetics. So here it is summarized that. So observe sequence. Here we are learning about the sequence of the the elements in the protein chain, and then reconstruct evolutionary histories, learn more about the evolution process, and develop better evolutionary goals. So that is, this is theoretical. Developing better evolutionary is theoretical, whereas observing sequence, reconstruct the evolution sequences, and these are empirical, that can be the practicality. Typically, phylogenetic study, one of the following type of questions. What are the evolutionary relationships or histories among species, individuals, genes? Can I better describe the process of sequence evolution with mathematical model? We can reconstruct a phylogenetic tree by looking at the nucleotide or protein sequences and combining this with our understanding of the sequence evolution, which is described using an evolutionary model. This enables us to interpret evolutionary events that happened in the past and also provides more information about the evolutionary processes operating on the sequences. Thus, we may refine our understanding of how evolution works and develop better mathematical models of evolution. So, in gist, phylogenetics means we are studying a particular species, and during the development of this species, how is it related to the other species? And at the same time, we can analyze the DNA, the protein of this species, and compare with the protein of the species that are related to it. And by genetic engineering, we can change the molecules or the contents of these proteins such that better species can be evolved. This can be done in plants to develop the plants which are able to produce more product, which are able to produce better product. That is evolution. So, this is phylogenetics is dealing with evolution of a species in relation to the other species which are nearby it, and the process wherein we can make the species better. So, that's about the phylogenetics. So, this part of genetics. Okay. Now, ontogeny. Ontogenesis is organization and development of an organism, both physical, psychological, and moral development, usually from time of declaration of egg to that. So, ontogeny, whereas phylogenetics is dealing with the development and evolution of an organism, whereas the ontogeny is dealing with development of a single organism, no evolution here, how it is originating, how it is developing. And then this physical, psychological and moral development, usually from the time of evolution to the adult. The term can also be used to refer to the study of the entirety of an organism's lifespan. So, the entire lifespan of organism can be read in this ontogeny. Ontogeny is developmental history of an organism within its own lifetime, as distinct from phylogeny, which refers to the evolutionary history of species. So, in phylogeny, we are referring to the evolutionary history of the species. That is, from which species it is evolving, and by genetic engineering, how we can make the species better. That means, how we can evolve a better species from this species. That is phylogeny. Whereas the ontogeny is only developmental history of an organism within its own lifetime, that is from birth to the adult. In practice, writers on evolution often speak species as developing traits or characteristics. Developmental process can influence subsequent evolutionary process. Example phylogenetics. Individual organisms develop while species evolve. So, phylogeny is referring to the species, whereas ontogeny is referring to the individual organism. Simply, ontogeny is for a single organism, its development from birth to the adulthood, whereas phylogeny is for a species, which is evolving. That means previously what were the characters, what is the relation to this species, and this species after evolution can go to which type of species, like that. That is phylogeny. Ontogeny is about a single organism. Ontogeny, embryology and development biology are closely related studies, and those terms are sometimes used interchangeable. So ontogeny, embryology is nothing but the development of an individual from the time of fertilization till the time of delivery, that is birth. So ontogeny is almost, embryology is part of ontogeny. That means ontogeny is development of organism till it reaches adulthood. No? So now embryology is a part of ontogeny, and developmental biology is also closely related to the ontogeny. And sometimes these terms can be interchangeable. Aspect of ontogeny are morphogenesis, the development of form, tissue, growth, and cellular differentiation. The term ontogeny is also used in cell biology to describe development of various cell types within an organism. Ontogeny is useful field of study in many disciplines, including developmental biology, developmental psychology, developmental cognitive neuroscience, and developmental psychobiology. So that is ontogeny, the various branches of ontogeny. Ontogeny is just the development of a single individual, whereas phylogeny is development of a species and its changes in evolution, where from it has come and where to it is going. And now ontogeny is having many branches like developmental biology, developmental psychology, developmental cognitive neuroscience, developmental psychobiology. So that's about the ontogeny and phylogeny. Now the period into which a pregnancy is divided, we are calling it as trimesters. First trimester, second trimester, third trimester. There are three trimesters in a pregnancy period. That is from the time of the fertilization, that is the meeting of ovum with the sperm, to the time of delivery. We are calling it as the period of pregnancy, which is divided into first, second and third trimester. The first trimester is from the first week to the end of 12th week. Second trimester is from the 13th week to the end of 26th week. And third trimester is from the 27th week to the end of the 40th week. So that's about the trimesters of the pregnancy. We have three trimesters. The first trimester is up to 12 weeks. Second trimester is from 13th to 26th week. Third trimester is from 27th week to the birth. That is about 40 weeks. And then we go for the viability. What is viability? The limit of viability is gestational age at which a premature born fetus or infant has a 50% of long-term survival outside its mother's womb. Currently, the limit of viability is considered to be around 24 weeks, although the incidence of varicocele disabilities remains high at this point. So, the limit of viability is gestational age at which a prematurely born fetus or infant has 50% of chances of long-term survival outside its mother's womb. See, now the pregnancy, as we heard, it is up to 40 weeks, but by any chance the fetus comes out of the mother before the completion of the term, before 40 weeks, is it going to live for a long time or not? See, from which age of this intrauterine fetus, which is intrauterine age of this fetus, can survive for a long time outside the mother, that is we are calling as viability. That means at which time, if the premature born fetus is coming out of the mother and trying to live in the external environment, if it can live for long time, 50% of chance of long times are over, we are calling it as viable period. That means from which period the fetus is going to live outside the mother, even though it has come prematurely, that means not completed the 40 weeks of pregnancy. So usually we are saying it is around 24 weeks of time. After 24 weeks, if the fetus comes out, it is viable. It can live in the outside environment for long periods as all other normal fetuses that has completed their pregnancy period, that is 40 weeks of pregnancy. Now, viability is a potentiality of the fetus to survive outside the uterus after birth, natural or induced, when supported by up-to-date medicine. So, American view of viability. So, view of viability changes from country to country, and in the American view of viability, they say the potentiality, that means the capability of the fetus to survive outside the uterus after birth, either induced or natural, when supported by up-to-date medicine. When supported by the up-to-date medicine means that is the incubator, external oxygen, external, the fluids, energy giving substances. All these substances are being, life-saving supports are being given, and after some time, if it comes to the time of maturity, that is about 40 weeks or 42 weeks, the baby will be survive. But only thing, to this period, from premature birth to the completion of 40 weeks, it is supported. That means it is supported with oxygen from outside, with incubator where the temperature outside is maintained, and of course other fluids and energy giving substances, all are given by tubes. And this is the viability according to the American. That means potential of a fetus to survive the outside uterus after birth, either natural or used, when supported by up-to-date medicine. That means life support is given such that it can survive long. Now, according to English, the fetal viability depends largely on the fetal organ maturity and environmental conditions. According to Webster Encyclopedic Unabridged Dictionary of the English Language, viability of a fetus means having reached such a stage of development as to be capable of living under normal conditions outside the uterus. So, according to this English view, what they say is, they feel that the fetus should have developed to such an extent that it can live outside the womb in normal conditions, that is outside the weather and without any life supports. If it can live, that is the period of viability according to English view. Viability exists as a function of biomedical and technological capacities, which are different in different parts of birth. As a consequence, there is at present time no worldwide uniform gestational age that defines viability. So, viability is depending upon the supports, the life supports, as in America. And according to English view, without any support, if it has developed to such an extent such that it is viable outside the uterus and continuous life, that is viability according to English view. And this viability and this exists as a function of biomedical and technology capacities. So this is depends upon the support that we are going to give to the fetus, that is differing in different parts of the world. So there is no particular period which can be defined as period of viability. So that's about the viability of fetus, usually 24 weeks in America, where they are giving life supports it can be up to even 20 weeks or so. And in some other parts of the country where they are not willing to give the external supports, or external supports are not available. That is, if the fetus has gone fully grown, developed to such an extent that it can survive outside the uterus without any life support. So that differs from country to country. So the viability is not a fixed period, but it is a period depending upon the environment or the support that we are giving to the fetus to make it viable, live or not. So that is viability. So viability over, terms of fitness over. Now uterine changes during menstrual cycle and correlated with the changes in the ovum. The wall of uterus consists of three layers: endometrium or mucosa lining the inside wall, the myometrium, a thicker layer of smooth muscle, and perimetrium, a peritoneal covering lining the outside wall. Until from puberty 11 to 13 years until menopause 45 to 40, 50 years, the endometrium undergoes changes in a cycle of approximately 28 days under hormonal control by the ovary. So the endometrium, so uterus is the womb. It is the organ wherein we are going to see the development of embryo after fertilization. So this endometrium, that is the lining mucosa of this uterus, is undergoing several changes during the menstrual cycle along with the hormonal changes that are occurring in the ovary. So these endometrial changes are depending upon the hormones that are produced by the ovary during the cycle, ovarian cycle or menstrual cycle. During this menstrual cycle, the uterine endometrium passes through three stages. So the stages that are followed by the endometrium in the menstrual cycle, this first one is menstrual phase. This is about 1 to 4 days, and this occurs if the ovum is not fertilized. The corpus luteum degenerates and the level of progesterone drops. So you should know what is corpus luteum, and the ovum, of course, you will be knowing. Here what happens is, in the menstrual cycle, in the along parallel to ovarian cycle, what is happening is the ovary is relieved from the ovum about 14 days before the next menstruation, start of the next menstruation. So this released ovum gradually develops into bigger size, and finally it releases the ovary at about 14 days before the next cycle. So this the residue after expulsion of the ovum, we are calling it as the corpus luteum. So this corpus luteum, once it has formed after expulsion of the ovary, it gradually degenerates. As it degenerates, the progesterone that is being secreted by this corpus luteum also decreases. Once it drops down completely, the menstruation starts. So due to the loss of stimulus for progesterone, the coiled endometrial arteries are spasm. So as long as progesterone is produced, the endometrial arteries are dilated and they are supplying plenty of oxygen and the sugars to the endometrium, such that it will be developing, it will be increasing in size and become spongy. And now once this progesterone has been cut off because of the loss of degeneration of this corpus luteum, this blood vessels start constriction and the blood supply to the endometrium is lost. So because of that, due to the loss of stimulus from the restaurant, the coiled endometrial artery sometimes is passing. The blood supply to the spongy and compact layers of the endometrium is reduced. Because of that, blood supply to the spongy and compact layer is reduced. The functional layer undergoes necrosis and sloughs off, and there is hemorrhage from the stumps of endometrial arteries. The sloughing continues until only raw surface substrate and basal is left. So what is happening is the endometrium, which has developed during the period of the proliferating phase, the secretory phase, and once the ovum is expelled, the corpus luteum starts degenerating. Once it has completely degenerated, the release of progesterone from corpus luteum has stopped. Once the progesterone release is stopped, the endometrial arteries undergo spasm. So because of that spasm, the layer, functional layer that has developed to a large size and has become spongy, they are reduced of their blood supply. So what is happening is they are slough, necrosis is occurring and they are slough off. And then once this, the spongy layer is removed, till it reaches the striatum basalis, up to basalis, the extra growth of this endometrium is removed, sloughed off, and there is bleeding from the endometrial arteries, and this is called menstruation. It takes about 14 days after ovulation, and in that period what is happening, the spongy and contact layer of endometrium are being sloughed off. So here we are showing primordial follicle, primary follicle, secondary follicle, graafian follicle. Then from this graafian follicle, the ovum is expelled. After expulsion, the remaining part of graafian follicle we are calling as corpus luteum, which is almost glandular. And then it gradually disintegrates and becomes bulbous, corpus albicans. And as this disintegrates, the progesterone decreases. And so the blood supply to the endometrium that has grown to this extent, stratum compactum, stratum spongiosum, that will be sloughed off. And this sloughing period is called menstrual period. Once it has sloughed off, now the next cycle starts with the proliferative phase. Follicular or proliferative phase, the proliferative phase coincides with the secretion of estrogen by maturing follicles of ovary. In this phase, regeneration of endometrium, which is lost during menstrual menstruation, occurs. So, in the proliferative phase, this is the follicles around this primary follicle. This will be producing estrogen, which will act on this endometrium and which will be regenerated, and it will be becoming more thicker. Secretory or progesterone phase. The secretory phase begins approximately 2 to 3 days after ovulation. In response to the progesterone produced by the corpus luteum, the endometrium becomes thick and soft due to increased secretory activities of endometrial glands. So here, after ovulation, 2 to 3 days after ovulation, the corpus luteum is going to produce more and more amount of progesterone, and this, because of this, the endometrium becomes thick and soft due to increased secretory activities of endometrial glands. And then once the corpus luteum decreases in size and it gradually goes to the corpus albicans stage, by which stage the progesterone secretion from this corpus luteum is stopped, and because of the stopping of progesterone secretion, the blood vessels of the endometrium constricts, and the endometrium that has grown enormously will be sloughed off. That is stage of menstruation. Premenstrual phase. The females usually the younger ones often complains of severe spasmodic pain and external spotting of blood during this phase due to ischemia of uterine wall following the drop in the level of progesterone hormones. So, as the progesterone hormones from corpus luteum drops, there is a ischemia of this uterine wall. That ischemia produces pain, premenstrual phase. So that is just before menses. There is a pain in the younger females. That is due to the loss of blood supply to the uterus. The menstrual cycle is a continuous process and each phase gradually passes into the next one. So here we are seeing the hypothalamus producing gonadotropin releasing hormone. So by that the adenohypophysis has a problem with that. The pituitary gland produces the FSH and LH. So because of this production of FSH, the corpus luteum, the ovary, each ovum is developing in size and the follicles or cells around the ovum produces estrogen, which is acting on the endometrium to proliferate, and as it proliferates it becomes larger. See, the size of this endometrium is increasing and once it has reached the 14 days before the next cycle, there is a LH surge. Luteinizing hormone is a push of luteinizing hormone is occurring, which will make this ovary to release the mature ovum to outside the ovary, and then once it is released, the follicles that are remaining in the ovum, they are becoming the corpus luteum. This corpus luteum is producing progesterone, which is acting on this endometrium, wherein the secretions of this endometrial glands is increased, such that this endometrium becomes spongy and of course more thicker. And finally, as this corpus luteum dies off, the progesterone levels drops down. As it drops down, the blood supply to this endometrium decreases and menstrual phase starts. That wherein the sloughing of this excess layers of the endometrium occurs, that is menstrual. Hormonal control of menstrual cycle. The menstrual cycle is controlled by the hormones secreted by hypothalamus, adenohypophysis and ovary as follows. So hormones secreted from hypothalamus, adenohypophysis, that is pituitary gland, and ovary are acting on the uterine endometrium and thus producing the menstrual cycle. The hypothalamus secretes gonadotropin releasing hormone. The gonadotropin releasing hormone acts on adenohypophysis, which in turn secretes follicular stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. The follicular stimulating hormone causes maturation of one or more ovarian follicle. The secondary follicle is converted to graafian follicle. The granulosa cells of secondary graafian follicle secrete estrogen. The estrogen stimulates uterine endometrium to enter proliferative phase. The level of estrogen rises to peak just before the LH surge. LH surge stimulates ovulation. Under the influence of large amount of LH, the graafian follicle bursts and releases ovum. Following ovulation, the luteal cells of corpus luteum secrete progesterone. The progesterone stimulates uterine endometrium to enter secretory phase. The hormones secreted by hypothalamus, adenohypophysis and ovary prepare the endometrium for implantation of preceptors. If fertilization does not occur, the granulosa cells produce inhibin, a protein that acts on adenohypophysis and inhibits secretion of gonadotropin, which leads to regression of the corpus luteum. The endometrium undergoes ischemic necrosis due to the decreased level of progesterone by disintegrating carbamazepine and estrogen. So this is how the hormones are controlling the ovary as well as the endometrium in the menstrual cycle. So first thing is the hypothalamus secretes gonadotropin-releasing hormone, and then this gonadotropin-releasing hormone acts on adenohypophysis, that is pituitary gland, which in turn secretes FSH and LH. The FSH causes maturation of one or more ovarian follicles. The secondary follicle is converted into graafian follicle. The granulosa cells of secondary and graafian follicle secrete estrogen. The estrogen stimulates uterine endometrium to enter follicular phase. Then, as the level of estrogen rises to the peak just before the LH surge, the proliferative phase also, the uterine endometrium also reaches its largest size. The LH surge stimulates ovulation. So, this LH surge is from the pituitary only, and this stimulates ovulation. Under the influence of large amount of LH, graafian follicle bursts and releases ovum. Following ovulation, the lutein cells of corpus luteum secrete progesterone. So once ovum has gone out, the lutein cells of corpus luteum secrete progesterone, which stimulates the uterine endometrium to enter secretory phase. So the hormone secreted by the hypothalamus, adenohypophysis, and ovary prepare the endometrium of the uterus for implantation of conceptors. That means in the secretory phase, what is happening is the endometrium is becoming more thicker and softer, such that it can easily allow the implantation of the fertilized ovum. If fertilization does not occur, the granular cells produce inhibin, a protein that acts on adenohypophysis that inhibits secretion of gonadotropin, which leads to regression of corpus luteum, and the endometrium undergoes ischemic necrosis due to the decreased level of progesterone by the degenerating corpus luteum and estrogen. Now, clinical perturbation. So, if we have any chance, if we can produce these hormones, hormonal effect from external hormones, we can produce a ovarian cycle, but at the same time we are inhibiting the ovulation. That is the key of the contraceptive pills. So here in contraceptive pills we are giving the sex hormone estrogen with or without progesterone is used in progesterone contraceptive pills. These hormones in the pill act on hypothalamus and pituitary gland, resulting in inhibition of secretion of gonadotropin releasing hormone as well as FSH and LH, which are essential for ovulation to occur. The suppression of ovulation is basis for contraceptives. The most common variety of contraceptive pill distributed by the Government of India contains progestin, norethisterone acetate 1 mg, and estrogen 50 mg. These pills are distributed in packets, with each packet containing 28 pills. Of these 28 pills, 21 contain these hormones and 7 do not contain hormones. Instead, they may contain some B-complex material. The woman is asked to start taking these pills 5 days after the onset of menstruation and continue without any break as long as pregnancy is not desired. Normal menstruation occurs during 7 days in which she takes pills without hormone. If contraceptives are taken on a regular basis, menstrual cycle occurs regularly, each with 28 days time. When she starts taking pills without hormone after 21 days, the withdrawal of hormone induces menstruation after 2 days. So withdrawal of hormone is in coincidence with the withdrawal of progesterone from the corpus luteum. So once the corpus luteum starts withdrawal and stops production of progesterone, the menstrual period starts. Similarly, any pills, if we stop giving progesterone, and then the withdrawal period starts and menstruation starts after 2 days of this withdrawal. So that is the physiology behind contraceptive pills that are acting on the endometrium as well as ovary not to produce ovum. So that is the complete aspect of this hormonal effect on the ovary as well as on the uterus. So that finishes our introduction to embryology, wherein we have dealt about the various stages of human life, then the three periods of trimesters of the pregnancy, then the viability of a pregnancy, then we are talking about the uterine changes during menstruation, the menstruation, the proliferative phase, the secretory phase, and premenstrual phase. So these things we have to read well, and then tomorrow our class is the development of the male and female gametes. Thank you.